Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saber here from Skew the Script. Today, we're talking about wealth inequality in the United States by using transformations of data. Let's skew it. Today's lesson is about transforming data. This is Unit 2, Lesson 2 in our sequence. And today, we're really going to be focusing on inequality in wealth. Specifically, in cities across the United States, you'll see that there's great wealth in certain pockets of town and great poverty in other pockets that could be very, very close to each other. And a lot of people question and wonder, is wealth inequality increasing? Is it decreasing? Is a society becoming more equal or less equal over time? And what might be causing those inequalities? And are we okay with them or are we not okay with them? So today, our specific analysis is going to be, is wealth inequality getting better or worse over time? And we're going to use our statistical analysis tools from this lesson to analyze that question. This is lesson 2.2. Please follow along in the guided notes. You can download them at this link right here. So we're going to start with the effects of adding and subtracting to a distribution of data before analyzing wealth inequality. A couple years ago, the Texas state legislature passed a bill in which teachers got a raise. And politicians in Texas decided, well, we're going to have a conversation about how these raises should be dished out. So let's talk about if they decided to do a flat raise, where everyone would get the same amount of raise to their salary or teachers. So say we have the salary distribution that we've worked with in Unit 1. These are all the salaries. Say there's like a master teacher or master administrator gets $185,000, and the lowest paid teacher, maybe a new teacher, gets paid $29,000. And we find the median and the range of distribution. The median is 34.5, that's the central data point. So the median salary is $34,500. And the range between the max and the min is $156,000. Now let's say that this new bill made it so that everyone gained $6,000. It's a flat raise for everyone of $6,000. So you add six to every data point, and this is what we come up with. Now the median is what we had before plus six. The new median is 40.5. However, the range, the spread, in other words, stayed the same. It's still $156,000. And there's a reason why. So say you have a data distribution. Here's like a normal curve distribution. We're going to talk about normal curves in our next lesson. But this is just any data distribution, centered at 10, standard deviation of 2. And let's say that we add 6 to every single data point. So the whole distribution keeps the same shape, and it shifts up by 6. So the new mean is going to be 16, the new measure center is 16. But the spread between the data points stayed the same because all data points move the same amount, so the spread between them doesn't change. The same thing kind of happens with subtraction, except it shifts down. So the center shifts down by 6, in this case for value 4, and all data points shift down, so the spread doesn't change. They all shifted down by the same amount, so the spread between them didn't change. Standard deviation is going to be the same at a value of 2. So when you're adding or subtracting every data value by constant, the center, as it subtracts by that constant, changes by that amount, but the spread and the shape remain the same. Now let's talk about when you multiply or divide a constant distribution. So let's say that we have a very, very, very simple data set that's composed of two data points, 1 and 2. Let's put those data points on a number line. And now let's measure their median, which is 1.5. You take those out together, divide by 2, it's 1.5. The range between them, 2 minus 1, is 1. But say we multiply every data point by 3. So 1 times 3 is 3, 2 times 3 is 6. So this is our new data set in green, 3 and 6. So we can plot those new data points and find their median and range. Now note that the value of 1, when we multiplied it by 3 and it became 3, increased by 2. So when you multiplied 1 by 3, you got 3, so it added a 2 essentially to that data point. The value of 2, when you multiply by 3, gets to 6. So that actually increased by 4 units. So when you multiply numbers, small numbers increase by a lesser amount than big numbers. Bigger numbers get a higher boost than small numbers during multiplication. So now, not only does the median change, the measure center go up because every data point shifted up, but the range, the spread between them also shifted because the lower data point increased by less amount than the higher data point, had a lesser rate of change. So when we're multiplying, big numbers increase more than small numbers. And because the small numbers change at different rates, the spread between our data gets larger. So what happens essentially is that both the measure center, in this case the median, and the measure spread multiplied by 3. So we see that same factor increase. So let's go back to our salary example. Say that instead of giving a flat raise to everyone, they said, okay, we're gonna give a percent raise to everyone. We're gonna raise everyone's salaries by 6%. So a 6% increase is the same thing as multiplying by 1.06. So if we take all these eight values, multiply by 1.06, we get the percent raise increase. So we do that. Here's our new data after we multiply the salaries by 1.06. And you'll notice that the lowest salary, $29,000, only increased by $1,700. And when we multiplied 185 by the same amount, it increased by $11,000 and a little bit more than that. So we see that extra spread coming in. And so what happens is, again, the median will increase by that amount, 1.06 times 1.06, same with the range, because the spread also will increase because of multiplication. So what happens in a more simple example in distribution, when you multiply, the center goes up, but then also the spread increases. So we got a flatter distribution with a wider curve. For dividing, the opposite happens. We decrease the mean, and when we're doing division, since the inverse multiplication actually gets skinnier, it gets more narrow. Our variability is reduced. In this case, when we divide by two, variability is reduced by a factor of two. So note that when we multiply, the spread also does change in addition to the center. The shape still remains the same. Now let's start our discussion into the topic we wanted to discuss, which is wealth inequality in the United States. So we're asking, remember, is wealth inequality in the United States getting better or worse over time? Becoming a more equal society or a more unequal one in terms of income and wealth? And note, we're not going to talk so much about income here. We're talking more about wealth, how much assets you own. So let's talk about stocks. A stock is a small ownership share of a company. So you buy a stock of Coca-Cola, that means you own one tiny little fractional piece of Coca-Cola company. So if Coca-Cola rises in value, gets a lot of profits, your stock rises as a fraction of that value rise. If the company you're invested in tanks a little bit, your stock value loses value because you lose a percentage of what they lost in value. So this is how stocks work. A lot of people invest in stocks. It's one of the most common investments of wealth in the United States. So many Americans invest their savings in stocks because they want to see it grow over time. The stock market, on average, increases in value over time. So stocks will increase in value over time and you get a share of that wealth increase. The S&P 500 is an index of stock, which means that it tracks stocks from a lot of different companies, specifically the 500 biggest companies in the United States, so among the biggest. And it's a good indicator of how the stock market's doing overall, because it has so many stocks in it, it tells you generally how good or bad the market is doing overall. So many wealth investments multiply in value. This goes homes, bonds, stocks, RA types. They usually gain annually value as a percent of the current value. This is similar to the 6% teacher raise example. Let me show you an example. So the S&P 500 stock index, that index tracks all those stocks, say we invested $185 in today's money, so inflation adjusted, but we invested in 1950. And we're gonna make a couple assumptions. We're gonna assume that this fund will gain about 4% value, so multiplying by 1.04 each year, adjusting for inflation. And we're not gonna get dividends here. We're just gonna get the stock value over time. So multiply by 1.04, in 1951, the value of your stock in the S&P 500 would be $192. Multiply again by 1954, that's over 200. And then you see this repeated multiplication, and it's exponential growth. There's more growth happening over time because we keep on multiplying. By 2020, you'd expect to have, just from letting your money sit there, $2,880. That's pretty incredible. This is wealth growth over time. And this is actually a pretty good model for what happens in the stock market. The orange line represents exponential growth, so that's that 1.04 times model. And the blue line is the actual S&P 500 value over time. You can see the model fits it pretty well with some variation. Of course, the market goes up and down, but the general trend is this upward multiplying growth. One disclaimer, you might be thinking, well, you know, it sounds like I should just invest all my money in the stock market. It's gonna go up, no brainer. No, there is variation. So look at this little bump here. This is between 2007 and 2010. This was the Great Recession of 2008. And what happened was thousands of families lost a lot of their savings because the stock market crashed. This means that one, when you're investing in stocks, you should invest long-term, so you ride out those bumps. And two, always seek guidance from a certified financial advisor before doing investment because there is risk involved, okay? So how does this relate to wealth inequality? Let's get back to our discussion question. So wealth is all the assets you own, the stock, that's your home value, bonds, et cetera. And we can see that for the bottom 90% of income earners in the United States, the bottom 90% of people who own wealth in the United States, so most people, wealth has increased over time, which is great. So wealth has grown. That's good. However, when we compare the bottom 90% to the top 10%, that wealth growth looks almost flat because the top 10%'s wealth grew a lot more. The wealth for the bottom 90% is small in growth compared to that of the top 10%. And we take that and compare it to the top 1%, the top 10% group now looks almost flat. The bottom 90% looks almost like very flat because the top 1% had the most wealth growth compared to those groups. So it looks like wealth inequality is getting more extreme over time. And my question is why? Why do you think wealth inequality is increasing? And think about multiplication when you're answering that question. Second question I have is more of a personal opinion. Is wealth inequality a problem? If so, what should we do about it? If not, why not? All right, that's it for today, statisticians. Goodbye for now.